Okay, so next topic is version control. Think of some versions like Windows XP, Windows Vista, Ubuntu 2, Ubuntu 7, Ubuntu 9. So controlling this version is a version control. So smart. Really? So what is a version control? Coming to again the first question. It's also known as revision control. It's like checking the different versions of a document. What is a different version of a document? Suppose you have created a source file, hello.c, and you have modified that source file in due course of time, and at the end of week you have 6 versions of it, and you have saved them 6 different files. Okay, you named it c Wednesday, c hello dot Thursday dot c, hello dot Friday dot c. You created 6 files which contains snapshot of each day, because you know that suppose, okay, take a scenario, suppose in the same C file, if you write in six consecutive days and you save it and exit it, would you be able to revert to any particular day? You didn't get my question. Suppose I open a file, I write some content, I close it. Next day I open the file, I write some content, append some content, close it. Third day I open, fourth, fifth, sixth. At the end of seventh day, can I go back to my first day version? No, absolutely not. If I make 7 copies of each day, so can I go to my first day version? So this is a very vague answer of version control. So you made a versions which you can control. Getting the point? But is it a smart way? Again, I will come back to the 1000 scalability. You have 1000 files. How you do? 1000 files you open in one day, 1000 files you open in next day. Fine. So what is not a version control? First see that. So generally people confuse with the version numbers with version control. They are not version control. They are the human readable. They are what you say end user friendly names, like Ubuntu 14.4. Does it 14.4 is a software version? No. It's an entire version. 14.4 itself doesn't make any sense, because 14 means 2014 and 0.04 means 4th month, that is April. So again they will release 14.10 in which month? October. So does it make any software versioning? No, it's just a alias of a broad operating system, okay, to give a better name. So those are not version controls, those are different version names. So never confuse with that. So suppose this LibreOffice 3.6.2 is not a version control, it's a version name. So what is version control? If you can revert to 3.6.0, that is a feature of version control. Now why we need a version control? Of course I can save multiple copies, and we have Google Docs now. You know how many of you use Google Docs? In Google Docs there is a, in the top you can see version history, okay? So if you click that, on the right side pane it will open a window and it will show all the previous histories, means when you started editing the file. So whenever you add something important and save it or close the file, it creates a version for you. It doesn't tell end user that it created a version, but it creates a version for you. And with that tool you can easily browse to and fro from this version to future version to backward version very easily. Future means suppose you are in 2 days back version, you can come to 1 day old version, you can come to present day version, like that. Why version control? First of all, reversibility. You can reverse to a previous version of a file. Why does matter to you? Means why you want a reverse version of a file? Take a best example. Okay, almost all software projects under the sun, they are under some version control. Some version control. It need not to be Git, it need not to be Mercurial, it need not to be subversion. Some version control has been done. Why we need that? Suppose you write a code today, tomorrow you found that there is a mistake in that code. You can't go back and remember what mistake you did and you just edit that back. It's not possible in a huge code base. What you do, you in a command line or in a graphical tool, you tell that, okay, go to that version. That is the one use, that is reversibility. Second, I think is more useful is collaborative effort. Suppose in a project like Linux kernel, some 3,000 people are continuously collaborating that project, which is such a wonderful end product. So if what would happen if each person is making changes and he's sending the changes using an email to Linus Torvalds, who maintains the kernel, and then he personally add that code into that file and then compile the kernel to test whether that code actually works, is it worth? I mean, is it a job which you want person like Linus Torvalds to do, to add email patches and copy them to Linux kernel? No. So Linux kernel uses Git version control. So Git is very smart version control. So who developed Git? The same person, Linus Torvalds. Why he developed? He developed to maintain Linux kernel source code. So how many lines we have in Linux kernel? More than 5 million lines. And it's a huge, huge project. Some 10,000 folks, and folks means 10,000 versions of Linux kernels are available. Many companies, they just copy the Linux kernel, make their own changes, put in their own version. Suppose the Android operating system, they took from original Linux kernel tree, they forked it, they compiled it, they made changes, they optimized it, and they released it their own version of Linux kernel. They again send back the changes to Linux to patch to the main Linux version, Linux kernel tree. So those things happen with the Git version control. So suppose many people can collaboratively work on the same version control tree. How? Suppose there is a branch for USB devices in a Linux kernel, and there is a branch means directory, okay? There is a directory for hard disk. Suppose I maintain hard disk and he maintains USB drives, and we both are maintaining the same project, Linux kernel. We are both contributing the same project, but not to the same file, okay? So he can also put the changes to the Git repository. I can also put the changes in the Git repository. And those two changes can collectively come into some server or cloud-based system where Linus Torvalds can pull those changes and he can automatically compile them. That makes the job very, very easy. So those things we will see in today's discussion. So this is the usability of version control. There are many version controls. The most modern and most advanced one is Git version control. We will straight away start with the project. Okay. So I am using Vim as a text editor. You can use gedit if you want. So I am used to Vim, that's why I am using. I will try to open gedit if you want. So what is the aim of this small project? I want to create a Hello World project, and I want to put that project into Git version control, so that if I want to change my previous version, I can change. If I want to collaborate people to my Hello World project, I can add people and I can make it a collaborative project. So those things we will see now. So before creating any project, of course, we will create a directory. I'm just copy pasting to save time. So make directory Hello World, where I'm creating in my home directory. Enter. You can see there is a Hello World directory here. CD to Hello World. Now you are in Hello World directory. The next session which we are going to dedicate is the documentation, and that is as important as Git, and we will see small portion of documentation in this step now. So it is always advised to write document before you write code. You think it's crazy, right? Means I haven't written a single line of code and you ask me to write documentation for that? Yes, it is important. Why? You are maintaining the code. It's not that everyone else around you know about what you are doing. And you are not supposed to do and answer everyone's question that, okay, we are doing this, this, this. So it's better to write a document and share with the world to tell them, okay, what this project will do in future. It's like a declaration. Okay, I am doing this, this, this. So it need not to be perfect documentation. See, the document become perfect at the end of the project. When you finish the project, of course you will add to that readme file or that documentation file. But at the beginning, you should at least mention the goals of the project. What you are going to do, what technology you are going to do, what all you thought about it, something meaningful. So before creating any project, what we will do, we'll create a documentation. So I'm using Vim as my text editor. So I will create a readme.txt file, or readme.rst file. RST is a restructured text, which we'll see in the next session. So I'm going to copy paste this content, this I for insert mode. Insert mode means I can edit now. Okay. So it says, what is this project for? This project will create a binary executable file, which when invoked, print hello world on the terminal. Okay, the formatting is bad because I resized the window. What prerequisites are needed? GCC GNU compiler collection, that is required. How to use GCC hello world.c -o hello. So hello is the binary, and .hello will execute the file. So do you think this is good to start with? Do you agree? Yes, of course, yes. Means this is simple hello world, that's why you know that, oh, this fellow is doing this simple thing. But if you start a big project and your mentor, your faculty, your boss doesn't know what you're doing, what you should do, you should create a hello world.c, hello world dot, sorry, readme.file, and you should mention what I'm doing. What I will do, I will exit ls readme.rst. Okay, to give you the sense, what I will do, I accidentally made readme go away, okay, something like this. I saved an exit. Now I forgot in which line I modified the readme file, okay. Without version control, what I will do, I will open again this file. I will search for the content where I have written go away, not in one file, remember, maybe 10 files or 100 files. Then manually I will change it to correct one, save and exit. Now I am in my desired version. But this is very, very crucial thing. Means if you are working on a company, on a code base, your boss doesn't expect you to do this with manual recall of your action. So you need a version control for this. To add this to a version control, what we will do, we will use git version control, and to start git, we will use git init. This is the first command to start a repository, and this command you run only once. Git init means git initialize. So this command will initialize an empty git repository in which directory? Hello world directory. So only your hello world directory is under git supervision now. So git will supervise your directory for any changes. Fine. It says created an empty repository in hello world.git. And if you see, there is no .git directory because any dot file name is a hidden file name. So ls or -l.git, it shows many files and directories. And you should not remove this because this is all repository files. Okay, you should not remove this. Control L to clear the screen. Okay, now you have created readme.file, but git doesn't know which files it should monitor. By default, there is another command, git status. This tells that what all there in this directory. It says on master branch there is no initial commit. There are untracked files in red color, it is written readme.rst. So git finds that there are files in this directory, but they are untracked, they are not under git version control, they are not being tracked. So how to track them? Git add readme.rst. See, I am using tab completion. Now you run git status. What it says now? Changes to be committed. It doesn't say untracked files anymore, because it says there is a new file, readme.rst. But do you want to commit whatever changes it has? And now the question comes, what is commit? Means why I should bother about commit? Commit means, see, it doesn't make sense that if you make a small comma or if you make a small typo fixing in your readme.rht, and you just say that, okay, this is my version, one of the version. Suppose this readme.txt, readme.rht is version 1.0. You just fixed a semicolon in this. Would you want to make it version 1.1? Is it smart? Of course not. See, there is a universally accepted nomenclature for versioning. It's undocumented rather. What it says is, there must be some significant change in the version, then you should be give a point version. Suppose 1.1. 1.1 means there is a significant change in 1 that leads to 1.1. If the changes are even more significant, you can even jump from 1 to 2 directly. If the changes are too small, you can say 1.0.1. If you think that's version, the changes are even smaller, 1.0.0.1. Okay, and to quantify that what changes comes in which category, that's again depends on the programmer. If programmer thinks, okay, whatever if function I change, whatever functions I have added, they change everything in the code, he will say, no, this is a major version, I will name it as 1.1. You're getting? But with a comma or semicolon, never make it a version 1.0.0.1 also. Means it's not a good practice. And don't do 1.0.0.1, just give a point releases like 1.1, 1.2 like that. So commitment. So this is the first time we are committing. So the first file, we know that whatever we have copy pasted in the readme.txt, they contain relevant information. We read through that and we know that it's correct. I want to save that version for future reference. I want to come back that version if something goes wrong in the future. I will do git commit. If I enter git commit, it opens a command line text editor. It's a nano text editor. It gives me a prompt. You can open, you can just change it in your git config file and you can open any editor. There are graphical tools for git also, but it's always advised to use command line. You can add a git version control tool in your Eclipse. You can add in code blocks, any IDE which you work. So this is the first commit, and with every commit, there should be a commit message. Why commit message is important? Very good. In future, you are human, right? You may forget what was version 1.0, what was the first commit, you won't remember. Then you should write in some text form that, okay, if you read that text or keywords, you will easily understand, okay, oh, this means this version, fine, I want to revert to this version. So I will say initial commit with what was there, compile instruction and execute. Okay, execute instruction or whatever. Control O to write, Control X to exit, done. You can git commit hyphen M flag means instead of opening this nano text editor, you can simply type your message on command line itself. So whatever I have written in the text editor, I could have done using a command line that will save my time and resources because I won't be opening a text editor by then. So I can write something here, but I already did a commit, so I won't do it. So now again, I will run git status. So git status is a command which you run time and again to know the status of the repository. On master branch, nothing to commit, because whatever file you had, you have already committed and working directory is clean. Now, if I open readme.txt and I add this text, okay, save and exit. Now I do git status. Now it doesn't say that nothing to commit or nothing modified, everything is clean. It says something modification have been done to your readme file. Do you want to commit? See, changes not staged for commit, these things. So how do you change, means how do you add this to repository now? You can again do git add readme.rht. So it will again add this readme.rht. But you can argue that I already added git readme.rht. Why to again add? why to again use read add command. So what you can do is you can simply directly do commit. Git commit hyphen am. So am, a means include the files which you have modified, and m means command line option for commit message. Now I will give a commit message, added test project details, done. So how many commits I made? Two commits, though they are very small, just for demo purpose I am making. I made two commits. Suppose you have 10 files and you have modified 5 files, and you don't want to include all the modified files in commit. Might be possible case, right? You have modified 5 files, but you want to make commit to only 2 files. What you will do then? You can, in that case, you will do git add those file names 1.txt or 2.txt. Then you commit. Then you make a separate commit for other 3 files. See, why we are committing? We are committing because we are creating snapshots. We are creating a virtual file snaps of entire directory, so that from future when we come to that snapshot, we get the usable form, usable directory, correct? So if you think I modified 5 files and 2 files modification, they are of separate domain. The other 3 files, they are of separate domain. If I make 2 commits for these 5 files, it makes sense. I can revert back to some version, I can revert back to some other version. Are you getting my point? It's hard to visualize, so we'll see in Git only. So how to view what commits you have? Git log will tell you what all commits you made. So it shows what commits you made. This is your first commit. If you remember, initial commit with compile instruction and execute. And this is your second commit, added text project details. Okay. So I am in the latest version now. I can move back to previous version without losing the information of present version. That means I can again come back to this version. How to do that? Git checkout and this commit version. So only 7 characters, minimum 7 characters are required. So I just copy the first 7, pasted here. It spits out some information, no problem. It says your head is now at this. Actually, I moved too fast because this concept you should learn a little bit later. So what I did is I just moved to my previous commit. So now if I view my readme.txt, that text line is not there anymore. Do you see? No. Now I realize that, okay, I think my previous version, the latest version, is the best version. I can move back to my latest version as well. How to do that? Git checkout, and you can do git log. Now, because git log hyphen hyphen all will show you all the logs. This is my latest commit. Okay. So I am in, the head is now at this, added test project details. So verify, let's verify using head command, head readme.rst. It's there. So with only 4 commands, git init to initialize a repository, git add to add files, git status to know the status of the repository, status is not mandatory though, and git commit to commit your changes, make your snapshots. You can simply browse among these files. Suppose you remove readme.rst. Is it possible to get back your file? We will see this later. So we have already finished these things. So these 3 are the only keywords which are required for entire Git. So entire Git can be summarized for this basic thing, which is git init, git add files, and git commit. That's all. And whatever extra features are there, they are just what do you say, feathers. It means you may use them, you may not. But these three are core things. If you know how to manage with these three, you are good to go. That's it. And we expect that you make Git repository for whatever project you are assigned to, and you should maintain decent commits. You should commit regularly. You should commit wisely. You can add. You should add good commit message as well. Now, more practical use of Git. Now, whatever changes I made, are they on some server? No, they are in my local directory. They are in my Hello World directory. Who else knows about it? Outside this room? No one, right? Now I think that, okay, I am doing something good and I have a friend in my US and I want to add him as a collaborator, and we both will work on this project. We have a startup and let's do it. Means I will do changes in helloworld.c, he will do changes in some other file, and we will make a program, we will make a software in some 1 week or like that. We exchanged email, we chat, we made chats, and we decided to come up with this project. So what I will do, I will copy paste the entire directory and I will email him. Is it wise? Of course not. How many times you will do that? If the project grows, it's not wise, right? Means you have to again wait for his changes. Means it's completely different scenario with email exchange and doing a Git repository, maintaining a Git repository. And what would be a smarter way? Smarter way would be put your Git repository in some server, on some cloud-based server or any server, okay, on which you both have access. You can start your own server. Suppose you bought some domain from maybe some service provider. You purchase a server, you install Git server edition there, and you told your friend, your collaborator in US, okay, see, this is the IP address, and I will push to that server. You also push to that server, and we will see the changes in the server. But again, on a server, you have to SSH. SSH means one has to log into that server and physically has to ls and see the files. Your friend also, collaborator also, as well me also. Again, it's not wise. So we want some web application which should manage all of this. What do you mean by web application? There should be some program running on a web server which should manage my Git repositories very efficiently. So it should show me the commit messages. It should show me who has committed recently. It should show me the difference also. What is the difference between this commit and that commit? That you can do locally as well, but you can see there. Who else can see that? Your collaborator can see that, and rest of the world can see that. Suppose I am a sponsor. I do sponsor projects. I will see, okay, this project has a lot of potential. Let me finance it. I will contract the collaborators. I will make a deal and may this thing becomes the next Google, this Hello World program. So those are the benefits with having it on a server. Easy to share, people can report bugs. Okay, suppose your program have bugs, people can download, check and verify and send you the bug reports. Easy to add, remove contributor. Suppose a contributor has resigned or he decided not to contribute anymore, you can just remove him from your dashboard. Okay, that easy. So there are many websites which provide that web interface. So GitHub is the very popular website. So how many of you heard of GitHub? So any other website which does the same GitHub kind of Bitbucket? Very good. Anything else?
Gitorious, Subversion,
and there are many such things. Okay, there are many websites nowadays, but Git is most widely used. Your Linux kernel is maintained on Git, and Git provides a very decent interface, for a graphical interface for all operating systems, and very good command line interface for all operating systems. So this is a small visual diagram. So this is your remote repository, which is your server.
Cloud means a cloud server, for example.
This is your local repository, means which file? .git file. This is your local repository, means your .git file, because your .git directory. Your .git directory contains all the snapshot information. It stores them. Okay, what do you think that .git directory contain? Does it contain two versions of readme.file? It stores only the changes. It doesn't store two versions, separate versions of, you committed twice, right? It doesn't store two commit to readme.txt file. It just stores one readme.txt file and the changes in the second one, and it put it here. Third readme.txt version, some changes with respect to one, with respect to two, it will put it here. So it will be, it will have changes, but they are not completely, what you say, overwritten, means complete. It will only store the unique elements. And does it store in human readable form, plain text files? No. It compresses the plain text file. It makes a hash of it. It makes a compressed, hash version of your entire repository, and then it stores so that no one can read other than you. So local repository means your .git directory. These files are your local repository. Cache means what? Git status. This is your cache, means suppose I do again some changes in readme.txt. Something went correct. So this is a cache. So there is a modification which has not been in the repository yet. This is cache. Okay, working directory, you understand working directory, this is your present working directory. So what is head? If you do git log hyphen hyphen all, it shows all the commits, and the latest commit is your head by default. The latest commit by default is the head of the repository. Head means, you can understand, means the topmost thing. Okay, if you have 10 commits, the topmost commit will be your head of the commit, head. And suppose you have multiple branches, so in git you can create multiple branches. Why you need multiple branches? Suppose I am working on a feature in hello world.repository which I don't want to merge with the master branch. So the default branch is master branch. So whatever you are seeing here, we have not created any branch yet, right? We have just done git init, git add, and git commit. We haven't created anything else. You can create git branch and a new branch, and in that new branch, what you can do, you can do some temporary modification. You can test it. You don't want to mess up your master branch. You want to just make some small changes, and you can want to see that, okay, this is good, then you will merge it with master branch. In that case, your head could be in your master branch as well. Suppose you are doing something, you committed in the temporary branch, so your head now points to temporary branch, not to the master branch. Okay, as I said, those are advanced things which you may or may not be needed for this session. And similarly, what else? Check out head. Okay, head, you just understood, pull. So git, before that we should understand what is git pull and git push. We'll see that. What I will do is, I will create a repository now on github.com, and I will push my changes to github.com. So this is my GitHub account. Okay, what I will do is, I will just create a new branch here, new repository here. How to create a new repository? Just go to create new and click on new repository. And you can name your repository here. So what is the name of our repository? Hello World. You remember, right? Hello World. Description may or may not be used, because this is used for just SEO purpose, so that Git will help you index your web page in Google easily. Create repository. I don't know why it is slow. Usually GitHub is most fastest and reliable. Meanwhile, we can see, so similarly, I have created here a new page with two options will be displayed. See that, why the two options? I hope the page has loaded. It's those 0.02% of time which they claim that the server might go down, and this is it. Fine. So you will be provided two options. So GitHub.com will tell you, if you have a repository already created, you just use these instructions. If you want to create a fresh repository in your local directory, use these instructions. So it will give you two options. Okay, so we will use the second option because we have already chosen the repository, because we have already created a repository, we just want to push it to GitHub. That's it. So create a new repository on command line is the first option. So this GitHub website doesn't know whether I have already created a website repository or not. So if I not created, then it says create a touch means create a readme.file, git init, git add readme.file, git commit hyphen m first commit. See, these things we have done already. Git remote add origin git at the rate github.com this. Then git push hyphen u origin master. These two commands we haven't done, and these two commands are related to GitHub. What these commands are? It says git remote add. Remote add means this is a remote website, right? So if I add this URL, so whenever I do git push, so git push will know where to push the changes. So where it will push? It will push to git@github.com/hello-world.git. So it will push to this repository. Okay. So suppose pushing an existing repository from command line. So I will use this now. And within IIT, you may face issues with git protocol. So what you can do is you can do HTTP. Okay. So what I have done, instead of SSH, I just made HTTP. Now the command has changed here. So git remote add, I just copy it. I will paste it here. Done. Next, what it asks you, say git push hyphen u origin master, and this you have to do only once. Means this entire thing, from next time onwards, if you do git push, it will understand where to push. The first time you have to tell GitHub that you want to push to origin means the first starting point, and master is a master branch. Git push origin master, think git hyphen v is git verbose. So with man git, I want to search the option which will print the info on screen, because it is trying to do something in the background which I can't see. If it is trying to connect to some HTTPS secure server or something, I can't see. So I want a verbose output. Hyphen verbose. Okay, now it is telling me the different push default is unset. Okay, so let me git push -verbose where -u origin master. Maybe this is a positional argument. Okay, fine, I think some issue with SSL certificate now. Anyway, if you upload to server, you can view the files here. And what next I will do is, I will add a collaborator. So if you push it, it will show something like this. Git push -u origin master. It will ask for your username, password. It will compress the file, it will push it, and it will say it created a new branch. I told you the new branch is by default is master. To create a master branch and push it there. Now if I want to add collaborators, so I will go to my Hello World repositories and go to my settings, and in my settings pane I will have a collaborators option. So I think that I can show you as this repository has not been pushed yet. Okay, there is some proxy issue. Now I know what issues I have. What I will do is export http_proxy is equal to null, and http is also null. how to verify whether dollar HTTP underscore proxy. So these are shell variables. So it doesn't show anything. That means there is no proxy set now. HTTP is also empty. If I do wget google.com, it is working fine. And if I try to send now, git push hyphen u origin master verbose. So you can add a collaborator. For this workshop, I created a dummy account with Akash MHRD, and you can just add him here, Akash MHRD. So he will become collaborator to this project. What he can do is git clone from the collaborator side. So let's assume this is your collaborator window. I already set it up. So I created an account in my, I created a user Akash in my machine. So user Akash will have all different things. Means he doesn't know what git repository I have, where I have pushed, etc. So who am I? I am Akash. Fine. Now Akash MHRD or Akash guy is my collaborator. What he will do, he will run this command git clone http github.com Srikant Patnaik hello world.git. So if my push have been successful, this fellow could have downloaded my entire repository. So how he will download, he will just do copy, because I have already told him that I will do this. Okay, it won't work now because the changes have not been pushed to the server because of some error. So when he clones the repository, he gets the exact copy of the entire repository. So whatever I made the changes, all those two commits, he will get everything. And as I added him in collaborator, as collaborator on this github.com, what privileges he will have? He can push the changes also. You can limit the privileges, okay? So by default, the default privileges are he can push the changes. Means to that readme.file, he can make some changes. He can push those changes to server. And do I get notified when he pushes the changes? You can enable email notification that, okay, whenever someone pushes to the server, send me an email. One way. The other and best way is don't rely on emails. So whenever someone pushes the changes, you don't assume that none of them have made changes to your repository. So at your end, whenever you make changes or you start making changes, what you do, your end means on your terminal. So when you do git pull, what it will do, it will go to github.com. It will fetch the changes, if any, to your local repository. Suppose Akash has made some changes to readme.txt, or he or she might have added some new file. When you do git pull, those new files will update in your home repository, your own repository. Okay, then you make changes, then you again push it. Okay, where? To github.com. Now what? This Akash MHRD will, if modifying something, he will initially do git pull the changes what you sent, then he will again make the changes in that, he will push. So it's a intermediate step where both the collaborators are working. So is it limited to only two collaborators? Not at all. N number of collaborators can work. But is it advised to work all the collaborators on a single file? Not at all. Because when you try to do git pull on the same file, the automatic merging of the file will fail. Because git doesn't know which file, means git knows which file this Akash fellow has removed, but it doesn't, suppose that file you have also modified in your local repository. So git don't want to remove your changes, your local changes. So what it will do, it will prompt you a window and it will tell, see, whatever I downloaded is the changes in the same file. Do you want me to continue? If you continue, you will lose your local changes. You understand? Then it will give you an option. No, you now merge it manually. So it will give you a file. It will show some arrows that, okay, this is added by Akash, this is added by you, this is added by Akash. It's a lot of manual job then. So it is not advisable in your project as well to add collaborators to work on same file. What you should do? It's always a good practice to have different files for different projects. Suppose in my project, one file does a socket creation in my HTTP, other file creates a visual window, a third file creates a user login. So don't add all these files in a single file. Then you will lose the usefulness of the Git. What you do, create three separate files, add three people to work on each file. All of them will send to github.com. You will pull, push, whatever you do. That won't affect your auto merging. You are getting my point? So this can be shown in a visual way also. So the same thing if you can visualize here. So what I am doing is, I created that project. I created a first file readme.rst. So these are steps, step one, okay? I pushed to GitHub. Then step two, Git clone. Who did the Git clone? Akash MHRD did the Git clone. So we both now have the same copies. Well, now he added hello world underscore dot c to, he didn't make any change in readme.rst, or he might be, he added a new file. He pushed it to GitHub. I don't know, I didn't subscribe to emails, etc. What I should have been done is Git pull, but I didn't do that. I also modified unknowingly that someone has modified, my friend has modified, and he pushed also to the server. I modified readme.rst, I tried to push GitHub. So this red mark shows that my push will fail. And how it will look? It will look like this. What it says? It says rejected. Okay? Failed to push some reference to github.com, Srikant, hello world, this. Why? Updates were rejected because the tip of your current branch is behind its remote counterpart. Tip of the current branch. Technically, tip of the current branch is your latest commit. Your latest commit is behind what is there in the server. Because server, there is one more commit added by Akash MHRD who has added this file. See, if someone is adding a file and pushing it to server, he can't push it without committing it. Correct? One has to commit it. He has committed readme.rst plus hello world.c. He pushed it. So this is commit number 3. So unless this commit number 3 I have in my local repository, I can't push it to the server. Both heads, my local repository head and his head, his local repository head should be same all the time. And the GitHub should also have the same copy. Then you can say all are sync. But now GitHub contains the modified version. He contains the modified version. I doesn't contain the modified version. How many commits I have? I have 2 commits. How many commits this fellow has? 3. How many commits in GitHub? 3, because he has already pushed. See the step 3. So step 4 will fail because I don't have the latest version of the repository. What I have to do? I have to do Git pull. Then I will get the latest version. Now all 3 of us will have 3 commits, all are latest version. Then I modify readme.rst changes, I will commit, then I will push. Is this diagram clear? Any questions here?
Yeah, we have seen this. Git pull means
pull from the, see, Git clone and Git pull are different. Git clone will, what it will do? Git clone will clone the entire repository. You need to do Git clone only once.
Collaborator, what he has done is,
he has done Git clone my repository only once to get my entire repository, present working repository from GitHub. Does he every time need to do Git clone? No. Git pull will sufficient to do the changes. What Git pull do? Git pull will fetch the changes only. I will also do Git pull. My contributor will also do Git pull.
So what we are doing here, I am doing Git pull.
So Git pull is a bigger picture. Git pull has 2 internal commands. One is git fetch, means fetch the changes from internet, and git merge. You can run these commands individually as well. Git merge. Git merge means it will automatically merge the files.
And that's all about
how to manage Git with multiple collaborators.
And git checkout, we have already seen how to check out to a repository.
You can do git reset --hard to this. This is also equivalent command. So if in some cases, if you git checkout give some error or you messed up something, if you want, if you are in urgency, you want to just forget about everything and just want to move to some version of your file, just do git reset --hard to that commit number. What is this commit number? This is this. git. These are the commit numbers. Of course, these are not human readable form. Your commit messages are human readable, but you don't remember these things. What you do, you just copy them and you paste in the command like git checkout and this thing, or git hyphen hyphen, sorry, git reset hyphen hyphen hard and that version number. Both are equivalent, but git reset hard will ignore any local changes and it will forcibly move to that particular version, which is not advised to do. Correct? Yes. You are talking in the sense of, suppose you have two collaborators in that case, right? Single only. Okay. Okay. You created a new branch.
It cannot be the same master.
Okay. Very nice question. So what he meant is, suppose I have these two logs. I went to this one. Okay. I went to this one from this one. I made some changes here. Okay. It's like going back in time and changing something back in time. And then I save the changes. I make a commit. Then I want to come here. Is it possible? That's what you are asking. Yes, it's possible. When you make changes to this version, it will, again, of course, you have to make a commit. And that commit will appear somewhere here. That's the latest commit, new commit. And that commit is taken from this commit. You're getting the point? In between commits. Yeah, they will be intact. No, it's not a new path. Unless you explicitly create a new branch, there won't be any new branch. Suppose you went back to, suppose these are, let me go to a directory which contains a lot of branch. I will give you example from here itself. cd hello world, git log. In between branches will not be lost because you have come to this branch, you made changes here. Whatever commit you do, it will come to the latest head. Means whatever version you are working, that will be the topmost version. That will be the latest version. So the head will point to the top of the repository, top of the commit. So all those intermediate in between commits, they are in between. And you are working here now. But you have come from here, not from in between. You have come from bottom of the commit. So you made some changes here, now your commit becomes this one, the latest one. If you make some changes here, again the new commit. Now if you want to come back to these intermediate commits, you can come to this one also. Here you made some changes, you committed back, and that whatever you commit, it will come to top only. No, same path. How it will two paths? They all are in the single branch. Forget about the branch. The branch, you have not created any branch. The only one thing is you have different commits. Let's talk about commits. So whatever commit you create, it just come up to the top. Branches, if you have multiple branches, then this concept might be a bit confusing. But still, whatever you work, that's the latest one. That's the topmost head. So let's move to our third topic, which is documentation. So whatever documentation you have seen so far since morning, they all have been created by myself and they are all been very easy to create. I have not written a single HTML line. I have not written any, I have not used any integrated development environment. I have not used any special languages for this. What I have used markup language RHT. RHT is restructured text, which helps you to create simple HTML pages and PDF pages. I have created PDF version also. So what you can do is, let me go to documents gnu docs cd version control events, or I will do make LaTeX PDF. Okay, it's already there. Events.
Events is a command line tool. Actually, events is a PDF
here. It's not a command line tool. And I have a PDF file here somewhere. Can you see? If not, what I will do, make LaTeX PDF. We'll see what all it does. Don't worry, I will explain this. I just want to show the power of RHT, which you can. Events LaTeX.
So it created a PDF version for the document.
So whatever you have seen here, it's a complete HTML page, right? You have a sidebar also. You can simply move between the topics. They all are hashtagged. You can just share this version with your friend, etc., etc. So they are website ready. Means once you write the simple RHT file, compile them for HTML, compile them for PDF, just share them. That's it. It's done. And as I already mentioned, that how documentation is important. So your rest of the period in your IIT and after IIT also, I assume you will keep a good amount of time separately for documentation, because documentation is key for success. You won't find a single project in internet which has bad documentation but it is successful. Any good project you take, any open source project, anything, they have very good manuals, they have very good videos, tutorials, they have animations to tell user that this has some support, this has some potential, we help you, we are here to help. They have forums, they have chat rooms, they have everything. Why? They want to engage people to use their own software. If you write no documentation at all and your software is next to anything else, means it's the best search engine you made, no use, no one knows. If someone knows also, he can't share with anyone else, because he has to explain what it does. He can't share your documentation. So if you want your project to be successful, first thing you should do is start writing a good document. So I wrote only a single RHT file and it automatically created this documentation for me. I hope you like this document, and it's very simple to create. These are the themes. So you can easily download many themes from internet. So these are the themes which we'll see now. So I created a PDF also, the same one. So this gives you the freedom. You write in a single page and you can create everything else. So let's come back to documentation. How to write a documentation? You can use your Microsoft Word or OpenOffice or LibreOffice, Google Docs, whatever you want you can use. But if you use Microsoft Word, can you make an HTML page with that? Can you readily create PDF with that? I don't use Microsoft Word, so I don't know. Okay, but that feature has been added in LibreOffice way back. Of course, the Office tool, using Office as your documentation tool, is not a smart choice. Using LaTeX, have you heard of LaTeX? It's a typesetting markup language, markup, and it gives you a lot of flexibility in terms of creating document, but it requires some patience, because if you get stuck in some place, if you are novice, and you might be in trouble some point. Wikitext, how many of you contributed to Wikipedia? One. Okay, very good, very nice. So Wiki has its own markup language, so if you try to edit some page in Wiki or try to create your own page, you have to follow their own markup language, which is also a bit annoying. Means I don't feel it very user friendly. There comes the restructured text, which we followed in this session, and there is similar one, Markdown. Markdown is also very good markup language, which GitHub by default supports. GitHub supports Markdown and RHT, and both of them are equally good, but RHT, you can do a lot more things than Markdown. So what is RHT? It's a open source markup tool, very efficient, well documented, used by many, can be used in any platform, Windows, Mac, Linux, anywhere. Why to use? To make manuals, documents. How many of you have used Python programming language?
Wow, I Again, I'm surprised. Very good. So Python, you have, you can actually in Python, you can comment the blocks, and those comment blocks can be exported to your documentation. You understand that? So if you write some comment block, and there are some utilities which you run on the, your Python script, it will extract those comment block and it will make a beautiful documentation with that. You can use such kind of documentation as well. But what I feel is more important is how well you write the document. It's not what which platform you are using. You can use Microsoft Word, you can use Google Docs, whatever. But the content should be very relevant and of high quality. That's all matter at the end of the day. Our readme.rst file we can view. So this is a RST text. So while pasting to this thing, I messed up the formatting. Formatting is very important. See how the color is changing if the formatting comes live. When I do readme and equal to underline, this converts it into header text. Header win means H1 tag for HTML. This means this is the title of the document. How do you know? If I do, there is a command RST to PDF. There is a command. You can install it from your Ubuntu by apt-get install RST to PDF. readme.rst. Done. ls. readme.pdf is created. Evins is a command line tool. Yes. But you see, there is something lost in the formatting here. I wanted GCC hello world.c in this box type of structure, but it didn't came here properly. That means there is something wrong in my formatting. As I told you, this formatting is very sensitive. I again open it. Let's go through the document first. So if you write something in a plain text, it will appear in plain text. If you leave a line, the final product will also leave a line. Okay. So suppose I write here, that means in my PDF there will be a line spacing and there will be a new line. If I write a topic with hyphens, underline hyphens, what it will do? It is a subtopic. What do you mean by subtopic? If you see this PDF, our version control PDF, if I go to my content, so this is my header. So this is equivalent to this. Okay. Not a version control. This is equivalent to this. And if you see, there are things in which we have third tag also, means there are menu under the menu. So if you go and make, instead of dash, you make caps like this. So this will become a menu entry under what is the project for. So if I compile now, I open a new tab, I will do RST to PDF. Why I am opening a new tab? I don't want to lose my changes there. Sorry, readme.rst. Done. So actually the prerequisites, because it's a PDF file, I think if I convert it to HTML, you will get a better result. I can't show you here that it is under the same tree. Anyway, let's come to our document. This star will become a bullet. Should have become a bullet. Yes. This will become a bullet. In HTML, this will also become a bullet here. So these are bullet points. When you give a star, it will become a bullet. And when you give a sentence followed with double colon, we clear these lines, and four spaces here. So this will become a block. What kind of block? See, I have to do two commands back to back. So it's not convenient for me to again do up arrow and perform RST to PDF. What I will do, I will say do RST to PDF, then do evins readme.pdf. And means if the first command get
executed successfully, then only do the second command. So this will compile and spit. Now you see there is a square box with hello world this thing. So what is this square box come from? With this two colon colon. So at the end of the text, if you write this colon colon and give a line space and leave four spaces, so this text will automatically convert to your highlighted box. And in your HTML, how it will look? Something like this. This HTML interface, the Sphinx interface, it has a nice option also to show source. So whatever document you are viewing, you can just simply open a fuse, click source. So whatever I have written for this basic Linux command, which we have seen earlier, this was my main header, introduction to Linux. Double star means make it bold. Let me open this in a new tab so that we can view both of them side by side. So this basic Linux command line application is this one. See, there is nothing to learn with this. You just do practice, just have a manual open at the side of your alt tab. See the syntax, copy paste, that's it. Introduction to GNU is my first topic, yes. This GNU is in bold, how to make it bold, star star make it bold. And there is a link, there is a note here. When I click it here, it will go to somewhere else, where at this point, footer. It says go to Wikipedia and read GNU. So how to add these notes? After existence, so after existence. Just write this within bracket hash and underscore. So this is the first occurrence of hash underscore. So this will map to first occurrence of whatever you write here. Is it clear? So the second occurrence of hash underscore is mapped to this link. The third occurrence is mapped to this link. So we have mentioned three times within that page. So first one is here. Okay, this, where is the second one? Second one is somewhere here, kernel. Okay, and the third one is here. Okay. So that's simple. Hash dot name, hash dot line. What does it do? This hash automatically enumerates your number, enumerates your text. So hash means one, it automatically adds. So you don't have to number or you don't have to remember. So this tilde tilde means it's a subtopic of this. So this Linux kernel is the subtopic of introduction to GNU. You can see figure dot dot space figure is a directive which is known by RST. So if you add this command given by colon colon, so where my figures are, where is my images, it's in data directory. See, I have not given an entire path of the directory, it's a relative path. So from present working directory, go to data directory, logos hyphen distros dot jpeg. Width is 100%, use entire width of the document, and logos of some GNU distribution. This is your name of the image. How does it look? It looks like this Linux logo. Come down, this another image, linuxmint.jpg, width 100, Linux Mint desktop. Fine, that's all. I think that's all about it. Means it's that simple. So what effort I made, I wrote it in a plain text with some markups, whatever markups I needed. And what I did, I just compiled it for PDF if I want RST to PDF. For HTML, I have a separate tool which is more efficient. There is a tool RST to HTML as well, but I didn't use that tool. I used a tool known as Sphinx, S-P-H-I-N-X. We will see how to use Sphinx to make these beautiful HTML pages. So let's come to Sphinx directory. Okay, let me create a Sphinx directory here. We'll follow our documentation. So these things we have already covered. Converting RST to Sphinx. Let me close the sidebar. So how to install Sphinx? Sudo apt-get install Python Sphinx. So Sphinx is written in Python. How to start? Just type quick Sphinx quick start. Why we are using Sphinx? Sphinx is another way to create PDF and HTML and EPUB and man pages. You can create many type of things with Sphinx, okay, by writing one single file in RHT. You just have learned how easy to write in RHT. With that single file, what you can do, you can create around 6 to 7 type of documents. That's it. So Sphinx Quick Start is a wizard to tell you what to do with this. Root path of the document, if you hit enter, it will take the dot. Dot means present working directory. Dot dot means previous directory. So hit enter to take the default one. Separate source at build directories, yes or no. This N means the default option is no. If I hit enter, no. Prefix template start with underscore. Project name. So this I have to give. So let me give Srikant. Enter. Author name, Srikant. Project version, okay, let me give 1.0. Release, means point release, I will say beta. Source file suffix .rht. Are you working with RHT or MD files? You have to mention here. So default is RHT, so I will say RHT. Name your master document. Default is index, let it be index. Do you want to use EPUB builder? You understand what is EPUB, right? EPUB is a ebook reader. So the document which I made, that can be without any effort converted to EPUB also. So on your mobile phones, you can easily read this document. Default is no, let it be no. Automatically insert doc strings from modules. Doc strings are the things which I talked about, the Python in between codings, means Python comments. Okay, in any source code, not in Python, in any source file, if you write a comment block and you want those comment blocks to be included in your documentation, you can use doc strings. Automatically text code snippets in doc string, no. So what I'm doing is I'm just using the default configuration file. What I did, I just invoked which command? Done. Sphinx Quick Start. All you need to do is Sphinx Quick Start. I entered twice, project name, my name, project version, and project release. 4 entries I made, other things are default only. Done. Now, what is there in my present working directory? These many things. So how to start? There is a make file. You understand make file? So make files are the scripts which when invoked will do set of commands automatically. So if you open a make file, you see there are some scripts already written to do a particular job. This has been automatically created by your Python Sphinx. So what I want to show is make is a command utility you install by apt-get install make, and this make utility can read these make files, understand these make files. So make tab will show me what all options are available with this present working directory's make file. This make tab read the entries in the make file and it showed me on the terminal. So it says that you can make changes, you can make clean. Make clean means it will remove all the build directories, make HTML, make development help. Dev help is making a help pages, the graphical help pages. So your Sphinx, Python Sphinx can do a lot more things. So all the things they are listed here, docs test, EPUB, create a help text, create an HTML page, create an HTML help, create a JSON file, create a LaTeX file. So this RHT file can be converted into LaTeX also. From there you can do LaTeX, PDF LaTeX and so on. It can create a Qt help. Qt is a development environment. Qt libraries are available for various platforms. XML file, you can create a plain text file. So we are interested in HTML, what I created in the morning, and where is the other one? LaTeX PDF. So I have created these two only. How to create PDF file other than using Sphinx? Using RHT to PDF. There are some other utilities as well. Okay, in open source you have limitless projects which does the same work, but these are the top projects which I am mentioning here, and the best one is Python Sphinx. So it does everything which is possible with RHT file. So just imagine you just wrote a simple text file in your text editor, Microsoft Word, wherever, copy paste it in your present working directory, run the make HTML, it will create a beautiful HTML page. Make LaTeX PDF, it will create a beautiful PDF file with all formatting, CSS, everything preloaded. If you want EPUB, it will create EPUB. If you want plain text, whatever you want, it will create. So I will create make HTML. Will it work straight away? No, it didn't. ls_build. So build is a directory which is created now. What it contains? It contains HTML. It contains index.html. It created something. Let me open it with Firefox. Actually, it didn't create anything from my content because I had readme.rht file in my home directory, right? But I didn't include that readme.rht file in that project. It's not like git add project, but you have to tell Sphinx that what all files you want to include. I didn't tell anything. I just started Sphinx quick start and said some wizard questions. That's it. But this is the default HTML page which Sphinx creates for you for the documentation. So welcome to Srikanth documentation. There is nothing here. So what I will do is I will add something to this. What I can add? I will add index.rht. This the index.rht is created by Sphinx. Here contents, you can change this title also. What I want to say here is readme, because we have added readme here. And what is the name of my readme file? .rht is not required, just readme is enough. Okay, save and exit. Now run make HTML. I hope this time it took. Yes, done. See, the plain text file now is converted to this, and this thing appeared in a box nicely formatted with CSS, default CSS, etc. So these are default which Sphinx create. And what you have seen in the morning is one of the theme. There are many such themes for Sphinx documentation. So I like this theme, so I included this theme. You can include any theme, you can create your own theme. Getting the point? That's all about this session. Thank you.